what's real, what's deception, what should we be paying attention to, what is it that's driving us insane?
The world will not be the same. Few people cried. Most people were silent. I remember the lines from the Hindu scripture, the Bhagavad Gita.
The New York Stock Exchange, the DK, and the Hang Seng as Manhattan prepares for massive evacuation in other cities. People are voluntarily evacuating population centers.
Something happening here.
Truth connections.
You can have things that happen to you in your life that are very traumatic at a young age, and you can choose to love instead of constantly be in fear. You can choose to work through it. You can choose to see the light side of a situation or a person versus the dark. You have to be able to look at where you've gone wrong in your own life and where you're responsible and where things went ugly, and then you see things more positively.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Truth Connections Radio. Happy Valentine's Day to everyone. Thank the Lord, consciousness is moving more in the direction to make every day Valentine's Day, and I, for one, can't wait for that to happen. But tonight we have a really special guest. Ironically, he came to us on Valentine's Day. I don't think that was planned, but it worked out exactly the way it should. We have a gentleman by the name of Joe Dolezal, and he's here this evening to talk to everyone about being enlightened, positive intention, spirituality, the way consciousness is moving, a special pyramid center he's working on, astrology and even little charts, you know, knowledge, Kundalini, pyramids and their power, and possibly, if we have time, even some extraterrestrial topics and related to the Illuminati, perhaps. So at this time, I'd like to welcome Rand, my co-host, and Joe.
How you doing?
How are you, Joe? Thanks for joining us tonight.
I'm good. Thank you guys for having me.
You're very welcome. We're excited.
Yes, we are.
Nice.
How would you like to start? Would you like to start off initially by talking about your pyramid project? Because I think that's a really groovy topic.
Yeah, we can start off with the Pyramid Center. It's what I essentially have. You know, the kind of synopsis story of that is I was very fortunate to, I guess, get as a gift from a lady who's now passed on, an older lady that gave me the property almost as a dowry, as a gift. And what it essentially is about 230 plus acres in the San Bernardino Mountains, completely secluded by forests.
Awesome.
Yeah, it's beautiful, you know. And even when you go online and you check out the photos of the area, you know, the pictures itself, they don't do it justice. You know, I mean, it's so gorgeous when you get out there. And then, you know, and I'm not even mentioning the energetic feel. It's just such an intense, positive vibe out there. And so what I've had, you know, like I've been working on this project. The property was acquired many years ago, but I started the project officially about 2006, which is about going on 6 years now. You know, and throughout those 6 years, I've put entirely my own funding into the project. It's been about, you know, well over $200,000 of my own, out of my own pocket, into the project. And I've made a tremendous amount of headway, but there's still quite a bit to go. I would say I'm pretty, you know, 60-70% of the way completed with the project, but there's still, you know, as they say, the capstone of the pyramid is still missing there. But I've made, like I said, tremendous amount of headway. I've done a lot of excavation there. I've made a lot of plateaus, a lot of foundations ready for buildings. I do even have a prototype bungalow set up there. I have solar energy, completely off the grid solar energy up there. So, you know, and if your viewers or your guys self would like to see more about that, you can actually go to YouTube and just type in the Pyramid Center, and there's a promotional video pretty much describing the entire gamut of what I've completed up there and what I want to go and do up there.
That's great.
Yeah, your visitors can also go to thepyramidcenter.org. So, yeah, they could even go there, and they can pretty much – all the videos that I've done, even, you know, mentioning some of the subjects will probably go over tonight. Or, you know, I did a little Q&A session with a friend of mine a little while back, and you know, they're posted there on the website, thepyramidcenter.org, as well.
Very cool. Yeah, that's a lot of information on that site, too. And I was surprised how many topics you actually did cover, even more than the show description that we had for you.
Uh-huh.
You're pretty much – you cover it, and it is all truly connected. We had Jason Verbelli on here, and he's on the science side of it. But it, mm-hmm. it is all, I mean, everything goes back to ancient times and healing practices and consciousness and stuff like that. Your site is not just about that. You have lots of good information and lots of good videos that we were checking out, so we appreciate that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, I actually just revamped it. You know, it was pretty much the same old site for such a long time, for about 2 years, and I just revamped it about a week ago, and I posted, you know, some of these videos that I did a few months back on the right-hand side, and then, you know, I swapped some links on here because when I do, I did a lecture on the Upanishads and magic. It was just kind of an impromptu lecture I did up in Palmdale, California for a friend of mine. It was just really just kind of a fluke thing, but we had a pretty good turnout, good audience, and, you know, I just kind of ranted about some things that I knew about magic and, you know, some of the Eastern scriptures, and then people started asking me, like, where are the resources and the references to it, so I even listed that on the website under free resources. There's a lot of good books. I mean, you can spend years and years reading them, and all of it's free, of course, so... So yeah, you know, I mean, you know, the Pyramid Center, the making of the entire project, it's you know, it has a very long and dynamic history to it. You know, I started, I kind of started my, I guess, search for knowledge or quest for knowledge in my mid to late teens. Ironically, I started this whole thing started this whole thing back when I started researching like string theory and quantum mechanics. And, you know, an individual who influenced me heavily was actually the book, The Elegant Universe by Brian Greene.
That's a good book.
It's a very good book. I mean, I ate that book cover to cover, literally.
I like that. That's a very good description.
It's
food for the soul.
Food for the soul. And, you know, ironically, you know, that stuff kind of delved me, you know, then when I actually graduated high school early and I went into college, and then I went from college to the University of Southern Florida, and I essentially spent about 5 years in the formal academic arena, if you will, and I studied mathematics and my minor was physics because of actually the influence that I got from Brian Greene's Elegant Universe, because the whole concept of, you know, parallel universes and string theory and conscious alteration of scientific experiments. What's that?
The zero point.
The zero point, exactly. That whole plethora of that kind of ambiguous quasi-spiritual science intrigued me so much that, you know, that's really, without even knowing it, that's where really my path began, is, you know, so many years ago. This was in the early 2000s. I don't know, it was around 2003, I believe, or 2004, when I was about two semesters away from graduating with my bachelor's in science from the University of Southern Florida. I had this revelation, and it was like, kind of, you know, it just came, and I said, you know, no matter what happens, I probably will never teach in the formal academic community. I probably don't even want anything to do with it, because, you know, it's very, you know, a lot of people have said this, that the scientists today and the formal academics today are really like the new religious cults of, you know, of the 1500s, you know. It's like a religious cult where if you don't prescribe yourself to the accepted dogmas of science, then you're either seen as an outcast or, you know, somebody who's insane. And
very true.
And, you know, and because my mind is so much more broad, and I have so many more questions, and I think even if you're a little honest with yourself, you see that science provides so little of an answer.
A lot of scientists and their theories, they don't want to budge on that much. They're pretty egotistical about what they believe to be true.
Very egotistical, and, you know, and the problem is, you know, especially at the university level, in the initiatory and the intermediate stages of the initiatory level of universities, they teach you 300-year-old borderline obsolete Newtonian physics, which is just ridiculous, because, you know, and this kind of ties into something that we're going to talk about a little bit later, but it's a little ridiculous, because even today, you know, they had quantum theories and quantum mechanics already well established in the 1930s, and then come 1940s and 50s, it kind of drops off the map, and this is where I think the whole quote-unquote extraterrestrial technology really took off in the government, but we'll talk about that a little bit later. And, you know, it seems just like in the formal academic arena, they teach people just garbage, you know, or half-truths at best, which is, again, this type of almost obsolete Newtonian physics. So because of that, I pretty much walked away from it, you know, and I flunked that entire semester. I walked away from the university, and at the time, I had a 3.8 grade point average out of a 4.0, which is pretty good. It's not the best, but it's pretty good up there. And
I take that.
Yeah, but I never looked back, you know, because intuitively, I knew no matter what happens, I have zero interest being in the formal academic ring.
This doesn't seem fair, because I'm a firm believer that you can teach yourself anything if you have a mentor and the availability to the knowledge.
Right. Well, and that's what's ironic, is that everything I know is completely self-taught. You know, I've had a few bones thrown to me here and there with, like, you know, Jordan Maxwell is a good friend of mine, and, you know, he helped me out with, you know, filling in a couple of the pieces of the puzzles. But, you know, in terms of my own research, it's, you know, it's everything was just kind of trial and error and, you know, logical deduction and then a hell of a lot of reading.
Well, Jordan probably saw, you know, you being able to reach another kind of audience, too, and, you know, giving you the baton pretty much to go with it, you know?
Right, right. Okay. Yeah, because, I mean, we see eye to eye with a lot of things. I mean, there's a few discrepancies, I think, you know, and I think maybe that comes to the ET stuff. I think that whole genre sees the whole extraterrestrial spoof that's coming right now. I think a lot of people want to believe that, you know, there will be extraterrestrials helping the Earth, but, you know, to me, it's, I don't know, I mean, I have a video on it actually on my website. It's not, you know, I mean, me, obviously, I believe that there has to be so much life out there, less and far more intelligence than the human existence here on Earth. But, you know, this whole thing that they're doing with the extraterrestrials, or will be doing relatively soon, it's so cookie cutter, you know, with what they've done in the movies, with what they, you know, shown how the movies are happening with, like, Paul and Skyline, and, you know, Spielberg's coming out with all these alien flicks. And it's just, this is exactly what happened with terrorism in the 90s. You know, everybody was a terrorist. And then, lo and behold, it's kind of like they psychologically inculcate or condition people, rather, to accept these things, because, you know, it really does all work off of each other. You know, the military, exactly. Movies.
They were being groomed.
Exactly, psychologically groomed, for lack of a better term, you know. And I don't know how much of your audience knows this, but did you know anytime you make any movie regarding extraterrestrials, anything military-related, anything state or U.S. related, did you know that you have to actually, when you get a major motion budget picture, it has to be approved by the Department of Defense for it to actually go into production?
Are you kidding me? I did not know that.
Go figure, huh?
Yeah,
and they're not even footing the bill.
And they're not, yeah, exactly. Well, they're not even spending or making it, exactly. It's just like, it goes to show that this whole thing is so interrelated, to play off people's psychology and really to form the culture and something. Not to mention it, you know, like I mentioned in the video, there's been so many prolific people who have mentioned that this is going to happen, and it's really going to be part of this grand conspiracy with communism and terrorism. And, you know, as they say, the quote-unquote last card would be this extraterrestrial spoof, and the objective of it is to unite people under a one-world order, a one-world government. And it's, you know, as sad as it is, it's like, you know, and this is one of the reasons I'm, you know, in recent times I've been kind of turned off towards this whole New Age conscious movement, because it's like, it seems that all these, I don't know, New Agers, we'll call them, for lack of a better term. It's like, you know, they love delving into the mysteries and conspiracies of government and high treason and shadow government, which is all great. But then when the biggest conspiracy of all comes with this extraterrestrial stuff, then that's not a conspiracy theory. That's legitimate, and that's what's going to save us from the government. It's just like, you can't help these people, I guess. You know, I guess that's the conclusion I'm making.
Discernment is one of my favorite words, and that's what we all have to use.
Yeah. And again, you know, and I don't doubt that there's a tremendous amount of intelligent life in the universe, maybe, you know, even in our own galaxy, and probably even in our own solar system. But, you know, it's so belligerently obvious that what we're going to see is just high military stuff. And again, you make that correlation because, like I've made personally in my own experience, you know, you see that in the 19, you know, first of all, in physics, they teach you, like I said, borderline obsolete physics, you know, like D equals RT. Distance equals rate times time, which is, you know, I mean, any physicist is going to tell you that's just kind of like a cookie cutter formula that nobody really uses in real life. And they teach you this kind of physics all the way through. And when you study the history of physics, you see that there's this big influx of knowledge around the turn of the century in the 1900s, early 1900s. And then around the 1930s, all of a sudden, they stopped talking about quantum mechanics a lot more. The subject matter as an academic study really went underground and went reserved for only, you know, specific types of people.
That's very telling.
Yeah, and not to mention, this is right around the time when the Nazis were experimenting with the Bell Project, which was supposed to be interdimensional travel. This is around the time when NASA got started. And then really we see this type of bifurcation, or the splitting, if you will, between, you know, the echelons of military government serving the people's interests. This is when government, you know, when military government really became the industrial military complex. So to me, it's so blatantly obvious on so many, and I'm really just kind of scratching the surface of it. It's so belligerently obvious that the military or certain aspects or certain people knew something. They figured out something, you know, the quote unquote theory of everything that Einstein allegedly was looking for. And that's something that we could even constitute as, you know, magic, which we'll get into later. They figured out the scientific formula behind it, and they'll utilize this for their new world order. And this goes into the ET stuff. This goes into the zero point field stuff. This is the, instantaneous travel between, you know, no space and time. This is the anti-gravity stuff that we're talking about, because it's all quantum mechanics. I mean, if you study, you know, even form the introductory quantum mechanics stuff, then this is where they all talk about it. So I'm of the firm conviction that they figured it out. They kept it as a type of science just to themselves, or to specific branches of the elite, you know, like NASA, for example. And then they basically just feed people garbage in the formal academic ring. And, you know, because of that, to me, this whole ET spoof that's coming, it's so ridiculous, you know, it's so ridiculous. And the worst part is so many people are going to fall for it, you know, and even worse yet is these people that are supposed to be on the front lines of the truth movement. Mm-hmm. You know, they're buying into it. They're buying into it so hard, and everybody's an expert, and everybody's starting to talk about, you know, how we're going to, you know, how we could all unite under one consciousness because these eight ETs are going to do it. And I say to myself, I'm like, damn, man.
ETs can't do that for us. They want us to do it.
Nobody can do it for us. But see, people want to take personal responsibility for themselves, which is ironic because on the one hand, everybody wants to be a sovereign, but then nobody wants to behave like a sovereign.
People not walking the walk and talking the talk, it drives me crazy too.
Right, right.
Yeah, it does.
So I'm kind of on my own thing, you know, because I mean, it's on most of my stuff, you know, I'll see eye to eye with a lot of people, but then when it comes to the ET thing, it seems that the people that agree with me on that aren't really kind of like you guys. You agree with me on the ET thing, so you're not really into the, you know, what would be considered the truth movement. Not that it's not the truth movement, but unfortunately, what I guess the world would see as the truth movement is really more of like a belligerent spiritual ego trip. And I'm not part of that. I don't want to be part of that. You know, you got these love enlighters that talk about saving the world when, you know, all they're doing it is for the money. You know, they're doing it for their own ego boost. And then, you know, they have the truth, but it costs $19.95. And I mean, unfortunately, those kind of people is what is unfortunately to the public considered as the truth movement. And it's disgusting and it's unfortunate, you know, but I don't want any part of it.
Very true. I mean, I don't care who knows who I am, as long as they hear the message. I really don't care.
And at the end of the day, that's kind of the conclusion I came to. You know, I feel like what me and you talked about, Kathy, yesterday about karmic destiny and celestial natal charts and, progressions and transits. I feel that, you know, as long as you're doing your karmic destiny, which can be determined by your natal chart, you know, then just whatever's going to happen is going to happen. You know, I've had people ask me, am I scared to talk about what I'm talking about? I say, absolutely not, you know, because everything I'm saying is, first of all, it's public knowledge. I mean, if you've done your research thoroughly, then you should at least know what I know, if not a lot more, if you've spent a lot of time.
Yeah, there's not many topics you shy away from either. You're pretty open to, you know.
Yeah, and again, you know, it comes down to that thing because, you know, if you watch this Upanishad video that I did on my website, then you could even see, you know, the way I kind of describe life is that in some respects, you know, and this is even what like high spiritual theories will constitute, that in some respects, life is kind of a curse, you know, and by that I mean that somewhere along the lines, each of us, each human being messed up spiritually somewhere. And because you messed up spiritually, you were put into this body that would have these type of, it would have an egotistical personality with sensations, likes, dislikes, hunger, thirst, cold, heat, and that you were supposed to actually reestablish the equilibrium within your soul or your consciousness through the human endeavor. So it's actually a kind of punishment to be in the human body. You know, according to some spiritual theories, and I kind of feel the same, you know.
Well,
so.
Some say this is the, not so much hell on earth, but the real part of living is when you die.
Exactly. You know, what's an interesting theory, and this is what, you know, my mom said once that really kind of stuck with me, is she says, you know, when she was a nurse in the Czech Republic, it's still under the communist regime, she was just a serving nurse, and she said, it's funny because, you know, she's like, I used to think about this all the time, that when you come into this world, every baby cries when they come into this world, but when you leave, she said, every single person I saw that was dead, you know, that died for whatever reason, you know, cancer or they were old or, you know, whatever reason. She says every single one of them, when they had actually passed away, moved on, they had a smile on their face.
That's beautiful.
So it's kind of like, you know, and again, we can go into this whole discussion. I mean, in itself, I could rant about, you know, the spiritual dynamic of death, but it's, you know, it's kind of like this, you know, it's, and what I always tell people, it's like, you know, have you ever stopped to ask yourself, like, what would be considered worse than the condition that we're already in? I mean, you could always imagine something, but, you know, like, would you say something like, oh, you know, there's not enough jobs or the food's GMO and it's bad or the government's too strict. And so when you start kind of looking at it in that perspective, then, I mean, situations can always be worse, but it's not like they're super golden right now, you know. And if you're honest with yourself, you just see kind of like the entire spectrum of your life. It's like you're born, you know, you go through the motions, you see your parents die and, you know, friends betray you. And then, you know, maybe intimate spouses go, you know, turn their back on you. You make money, then you lose money, you know, and you get older. And so it's a kind of like, not to look at it from a cynical perspective, but I can see that argument where one would say that, you know, the human existence is more of a curse than it is a blessing.
What's a divine cosmic test, if you will?
Sure, yeah. Exactly.
And I don't know if I'm right, but this is just a thought I have. You hear also stories about people that have near-death experiences that talk about seeing hell. In my opinion, that's not really hell, but it's a divine scared straight program from the source to say, now go back there and get it right. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I'm not so sure that hell exists.
Well, I guess what I was trying to say is I think we're in hell.
that was what I was trying to say, too. But I was just commenting on how, you know, there's these shows out today that talk about near-death experiences and what people have seen. And there's been some people that have seen, they say, hell, you know? And I think that maybe that's just a divine lesson for them to be scared straight, you know, while they're up there out of their body, so they can come back and get it right without having to be actually dead and to come back as a baby again. You know what I mean?
Right. And you know, I know, and I agree with you, you know, and I think the objective of life, you know, and I think like what I mentioned before is that something, your consciousness somehow messed up spiritually at some point and it variegated in its equilibrium. So it essentially polarized to one side or the other a little bit too much. And because of that, you were kind of put into this body to reestablish that equilibrium through phenomenal existence. And, you know, on that note, to me, and this is what they even say, and this is even what kind of corroborates with even, you know, essentially every spiritual, even religious dogma, when you look at it, when you read in between the lines, is that, you know, you have to establish that equilibrium within yourself and see the common thread between all things, not even necessarily people, but even ideologies, animals, apparently inanimate objects. And you really have to establish a type of unabridged love with things, you know, and I don't mean love like lovey-dovey, you know, let's go to a party and, you know, and smoke weed. I mean more like it's a certain universal, extremely in-depth understanding of situations and accepting things as they are and even embracing things
surrender.
As they are.
Surrender to it.
It is. It's a type of, but not an indifferent surrender. It's more of an embracing surrender.
Yes, absolutely.
Exactly. And I think that's what the objective of life is. So, you know, when I get these questions, are you scared to do what you do? And then to me, I say, listen, I'm doing what I feel I was meant to do. If I get a bullet in the head, that's fine.
So
but
do I feel the exact
same. I just, you know, my only request is not to come back. That's it.
Yeah. Make sure you got that crown chakra fired up if they take a shot at you.
because I mean, if you piss off the wrong people, one thing that I know for a fact, that if you piss off the wrong people in this world, then they'll make your death look like a complete accident and have the entire world supporting it, you know?
Absolutely.
So there's no reason to fighting what you can't fight.
Very true.
Mm-hmm.
It is.
What are your thoughts? This is a personal question for me. I know we're probably going to go all over the place because there's so many topics to talk about, but as far as the New Age movement goes and spirituality and zero point and Kundalini and all that, what are your thoughts on personal physical relationships and sexuality while you're trying to be more enlightened? Because I have theories on that too.
I think, you know, personal relationships is a slightly more broad subject. You know, I think obviously likes attract likes, and I think you meet certain people for certain reasons. And I think, you know, generally what it is that you try to essentially meet your opposite to, again, reestablish that equilibrium. This is why, you know, oftentimes you'll find, you know, very weak and secure girls with strong, dominating kind of a-hole guys. because it's a type of equilibrium which is trying to struggle for balancing again itself. And, you know, so I think that's what happens in even any kind of relationship, not necessarily intimate relationships, but even, you know, with, you know, I think that you come into this earth, like with your family, if you kind of observe, then maybe, you know, you're a little bit more liberal, your brother and sister will be a little bit more, I guess, conservative in their attitudes. And this whole, even like family dynamic, it has a certain equilibrium within itself when you look at it as a whole.
That's very true.
Yeah. And so when it comes to like personal relationships, I think what it is, you know, I mean, I think, you know, even these, you know, sexual relationships or intimate relationships, essentially, you're just looking for that other half. But you're seeing, when you look for that other half, it is obviously being expressed in a type of, you know, sexual manner, sexual demeanor. But it's just a more intensification of any other process, you know, and that's why even, you know, sexuality is essentially an inner expression. That's what you're really doing. So, you know, if you like grotesque S&M style sex, then what you're really doing is expressing an inner tendency, and you're trying to exhaust that inner tendency, as they say in the spiritual literature, in the spiritual world. They say you're trying to exhaust it by experience, because when you experience it, after an X amount of experiences, whether it's 100 of them or 50 of them or 1,000 of them, then comes a certain knowledge with that experience. And that knowledge just becomes that wisdom of understanding, which kind of comes back to what we were talking about, that the objective of life and even the objective of all things is to come up with a type of universal consciousness, a universal understanding, and a universal wisdom of all things. So with relationships, in regards to relationships, I think these are just, you know, we're just trying to experience certain things so that we get an understanding, because intuitively it's not even psychological. I think it's something much more deep than that. I think intuitively we know that there's an error in our being, an error in our consciousness, and so we look for certain experiences to remedy that error. And that's why, you know, some people go through extremely bad drug phases, because you know, for whatever reason, they're trying to understand that, or they go into really bad relationships, or they can get, you know, beat up or go to jail. I mean, you know, some people need that extremity because it, you know, despite the fact that it seems very chaotic, it actually, it imbues them, ultimately imbues them with a sense of understanding about things.
Yes, very true. I tell people, if something bad happens to you, you know, and you're sad, feel the pain, let it go,
right.
Look for the lesson, and don't,
right.
don't go back there again.
Right. Look for the lesson, yeah, and that's the thing, you know, if you look for the lesson but you don't understand the message, you got to go back there, and that's the unfortunate reality of
that's
it, you know.
Point.
I mean, I know many times I know something's bad, and I just keep going into it until you learn your lesson, you know. I mean, I don't want to go into details about what, but
I think
we've all been there where you know something's bad intellectually, but consciously in your heart you don't get it, you know. And so you just kind of keep running into the flame, as it were, you know.
Right, that happens.
Yeah.
Very true. And also, I know some people say that, you know, to reach that kundalini or spiritual higher consciousness that everyone wants, that it's not good to have, you know, promiscuous sex or to be with a partner that you don't really love,
mm-hmm.
because you're not going to be able to get there. It's going to hinder you. You know, from
right. The entire concept of celibacy is again, it's a little bit miscued, and you got to be extremely cautious how you take it, you know, because we see, like, for example, in like the Catholic priests, for example, and you see this all the time, and this is a very common thing. You know, they're molesting little children and just involved in very strange and very abstract sexual things with, you know, young children, young women, not even women, rather girls, that are 11 years old, 8 years old, 5 years old.
When you take it away for life, yeah, I agree with you. But I'm just speaking of, you know, if you're trying to reach that higher consciousness.
Right. Well, I'm going to get to that in just
okay,
a second.
Okay, sorry.
No, that's okay. No, because I kind of like to establish a foundation and then move into
it. Oh, no problem.
You kind of have, yeah, one thing to really get the other. You know, the entire objective of celibacy in the spiritual pursuit is that you're essentially, you know, you're a cosmic being. You got to look at yourself, like, for now, just look at yourself as an individual cosmic unit, a certain consciousness which broke away from the absolute consciousness, which we can call God. And that breaking away is essentially, it was a type of self-affirmation that happened in the consciousness, which later evolved into the physical body that you are today. So what happens is, when, you know, the word religion, it actually means to bind back. That's what it means. It means to bind back the consciousness inside, because either your consciousness is expressing itself outwardly, which is in the form of whatever, you know, walking, talking, seeing things, smelling things, hearing things, any kind of action. And when you do that, then you're actually dissipating that conscious spiritual energy when you're moving it outward, which is basically what they call the phenomenal existence. When you turn it inward, which is binding the consciousness back, which is the basis of true religion, then you're actually conserving that energy. And by conserving that energy and pushing it back into yourself, creating a closed loop, as it were, then you start actually, this is really what the real definition of meditation is, or even the real purpose of meditation, because you're starting to sublimate all that external energy back into yourself, and you're becoming like the sun. You know, it's a slightly abstract concept to understand off the bat, and I'll get into the sun thing a little bit later, but why I'm saying the sexuality is important is because the reason in spirituality they say to abstain from sex, not because it's not holy, it's not divine, but because you're spending a tremendous amount of energy in the external. And there's nothing wrong with that, but it's just the opposite of putting it back into yourself for the purposes of meditation and for a conscious understanding of situations. Because you can go outwardly and move your consciousness outward to understand things phenomenally, but the problem with that in terms of spiritual theory is that you're going to take a lot of lifetimes to understand that every experience is essentially the same. You know, it has a type of ebb and flow, and then you learn something and that's it. But at the end of the day, no matter how much you experience, you still have to kind of go back into your heart. And you have to realize that inner consciousness, and that's why they just suggest more of like a spiritual life, turning the consciousness inward, and this is why they recommend abstaining from sex. Is because sex, obviously, it spends a tremendous amount of energy. It's not that it's not holy. It's not that it's, you know.
And it's also kind of blending your aura with that person, you know. And if it's
exactly. And what you're doing is, because you don't really know that person spiritually. I mean, you might sync up or resonate in certain facets, but at the end of the day, nobody really knows anybody full and full. It's impossible. You know, you don't really know the deep latent tendencies of your children or your mom or your dad. I mean, you know them to a certain extent, but nobody really knows anybody. And so when you're doing that, you're taking everything. You're not just taking the part that you think is good. You're taking everything. And because of that and that kind of miscalculated judgment, then generally all of our relationships almost always without exception end in sorrow, whether they're intimate or not, is because we don't see those latent potentials in people which are essentially disharmonious with us. And that's why, you know, you could be with somebody for, you know, 5, 10, 20, 30 years, and then all of a sudden you're like, I don't like this person. Why the hell did I waste this much time with the person? Because you chose to see something which wasn't there, you know. And so when it comes to sexuality, you know, I mean, there's, of course, there's this whole feature of tantric sex, which is more energy building, and there's validity to that. But then there's that dynamic that suggests turning the consciousness inward, because there's no residue, as it were. You know, when you're integrated in any kind of phenomenal experience, there's always residue. And this residue is what we call karma. It's a reaction from your action. When you do it, when you create any kind of an intention, not necessarily physical, but it's a spiritual intention, what you're doing to the universe is you're pushing certain waves out. And because equilibrium is the law of the universe, naturally something's going to push back at you. And that's really the downfall of phenomenal experience, is when you try to express something even sexually, or even when you think you're helping people, what you're really doing is you're creating a type of positive flow outside. Well, again, because the universe seeks equilibrium and not necessarily positivity, then there's always going to be this negative repercussion somewhere down the line in some form. And this is why they say, you know, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. That's where that comes from. And this is why, you know, anytime that you try to help somebody, generally you actually do much worse. You know, if you have a drug addict and you say, oh, I want to help them, or I want to, you know, I want to put them in a clinic, or I want to give them money, then, you know, it's like people seem to have to help themselves. And unless that's there, then, you know, they're not going to. But the point I'm trying to make about sexuality is that, you know, from a spiritual perspective, there's not, it's not to say that there's nothing that can be experienced, I guess, in a more, there's nothing that can not be gained from the sexual experience. But this is why a lot of them essentially talk about restraining from the sexual exercises, because when you do meditation, or when you turn the consciousness inward, there's no karmic repercussion and there's no spiritual residue, as it were. And it's a little bit more of a cleaner approach to wisdom, or spiritual wisdom.
Yeah, there's many different ways to look at it. People get confused, I think, but that's, you have to go with what's right for you and your own discernment.
And, you know, one thing that I've realized, and this is such a – and I almost don't talk about it, because without – a tremendous amount of experience, and, you know, generally people who are older will agree with me on this, there's such a huge difference between emotions and intuition that, you know, when you're younger, something might seem so right, you might be so convinced that it's right, that you're just completely stupefied later when you realize it isn't right. And, you know, your intuition will never lead you wrong, never. But that difficulty is discerning between positive emotion wanting something and believing that something is right, believing, which is, you know, relative perception, and something which you know is intuitively right.
A lot of that goes back to ego, though, too, I think.
It goes back to ego, because when you see a positive, you know, when you see something which is of a positive nature, something that you say you want, exactly, that's a characteristic of the ego wanting to essentially ossify and maintain its ego, you know, whether it's money or whether it's a, you know, a relationship. And this is kind of why I try to always stay away from the relationship, because I think a lot of people, they get involved with spirituality because life doesn't seem to be working out for them, which is great. But to me, spirituality is something, to me, spirituality is kind of the bifurcation, or essentially the cessation of the phenomenal world, and really trying to cessate that consciousness from external activity and going back internal activity. That process is very brutal. You know, it's not an easy process at all. Meditation is probably one of the hardest things you can ever try to do in your life, you know. True meditation, in terms of, I mean, just, you know, for your audience or yourself, try to just concentrate when we get off the show tonight. Just try to focus on one thing for even 5 minutes. So we haven't even intermittent meditation. We're just talking about a concentration. And it is a very, very difficult subject. It's a very difficult thing to even achieve a little bit of concentration. But when you do it successfully, I mean, it's amazing. You know,
when you stare at a flame, it helps, I think.
Anything, right. There are techniques, you know, I mean, we can go into that. You know, there's many techniques. You can stare into a candle flame just to get your brain prepared for it. You know, you could even meditate on something that is of value to you, because your brain and the energy will naturally kind of gravitate towards that. But, you know, I mean, I've been in situations where I've meditated for 30 minutes or an hour, and when I come out of it, my whole face is, you know, just it's numb and it's tingling. And
That's cool, isn't it? I love that.
it's really life transformational, and it's nothing that could even be articulated in words, because words are just merely things that we try to put on phenomenal things, but we're not dealing with the phenomenal subject in meditation anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you know, that's kind of, you know, some people again, you know, when we get into the subject of love and relationships, that's fine and dandy. And that, of course, it does serve a purpose, like we mentioned, in terms of karmic exhaustion and the necessity to experience things as a human being. But when we talk about true spirituality, or rather the more austere and orthodox form of spirituality, like meditation or concentration, I feel that they're slightly different things.
Now, what about binaural beats for meditation? I use those. Is that cheating or...
No.
They certainly help. They help me focus. I got the monkey mind really bad.
I feel a little bit of everything. Sometimes I'll do that. Sometimes I'll just be alone with myself. Sometimes I'll do the Monroe Institute stuff. You know, just mix it up, you know?
Yeah, sure.
Right, and there is no right or wrong way, you know. And this is one of the things they even talk about in Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, is that essentially, you know, everything, even in the physical cosmos, is part of the divine whole. So you could even, you know, if you have enough willpower and you have enough interest in it, you could even concentrate on a rock, you know, a pen, a shoe. It doesn't necessarily have to be, you know, an ionic image of Jesus Christ or Buddha or, you know, or Shiva or anything like that. But the idea is that your mind has to be fully focused towards that, because, you know, as they say, the you know, wherever your energy goes, the attention flows, and then essentially something evolves out of it.
Yeah.
So, you know, even binaural beats, if it concentrates the rays of your mind, that's absolutely fine. You know, I mean, I would even say that's just a form of mantra, essentially.
Where energy goes, intention flows.
Exactly. And, you know, I would say even any kind of music, it's a form of mantra. And if it puts you in that hypnotic state where you don't fall asleep, of course, then
I meditate,
you know, that...
Pink Floyd sometimes. It works for me. You know?
I actually went to my first Pink Floyd concert about a year ago, and it's pretty amazing. But but that's something to discern from, you know. And there's many forms of meditation. You know, meditation isn't necessarily sitting in Padashana, you know, and in some kind of a weird yogic posture with you know, a white cloak over you with your eyes closed. I mean, that's just a very generic form of meditation. But meditation could even be working on, you know, a garden, you know, in the bhakti traditions of yoga. It's called bhakti yoga. It's a prescription that you're supposed to essentially surrender to the world. It's a form of yoga, a form of attaining liberation, is that you're supposed to actually attend to the world, and you're supposed to essentially give your all to the world without asking anything in return. And that's a form of meditation. Yeah. So, you know, there's many forms of meditation. You don't have to necessarily sit in some type of an austere position and have your eyes closed and, you know, ramble some type of, you know, prayers for hours on it. And it's a form of meditation, but there's many forms of meditation. The idea is that you're taking all your energy and all your thoughts and all your mind into one pinpoint. That's the objective.
Yeah, the idea is to get out of your head.
Right.
Surrender to it and let go, you know?
And you're trying to concentrate all your energy into a pinpoint because you want to pierce, as they say, the physical illusion of the world, you know? Pierce Maya with that intensity. And I actually made a sample of that. You know, you guys might have heard this adage before, but I loved it when I heard it many years ago, is that, you know, if you take a 100-watt light bulb in a room, it could just essentially light up a room, and in some cases even dimly if the room's big. But if you take that same 100 watts and turn it into a diode laser, you can cut steel, you know. And it's essentially, it's a 100 watts of electricity or photons. Nothing has changed, but the intensity, the concentration of that photon and the concentration of that light. So it just goes to show how much power you latently, innately have in yourself, in your mind, in your body, in your consciousness. It's just a matter of focus. It's a matter of concentration. And then you'd be truly amazed of what you yourself have even capable of doing.
Just finding coherency.
Exactly. And everybody's got a different form, you know. If dineural, if those beats, I know what you're talking about. It's the, I actually was reading
alpha, up on, theta waves.
Right. And they do
theta.
Put you in a trance. It's like what in the yogic literature they would consider a type of mantra, especially if it's on like a type of repetition and you're focusing on it, then yeah.
I think it's good to mix it up. You do whatever feels good that day.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, that's kind of, you know, that's kind of some of the brief conclusions I came about on, you know, yogic meditation. Do we have to take a break, or are we still good?
If you want to take one now, we can, and come back, but this is a good place for you to stop.
Okay, let's do that, because I'm going to grab a glass of water. So
okay, great. Well, at this time, I am going to tell everyone the intro song was a new artist that we're featuring here on our show, Protetius, and that song was called With Christ. And we're going to take a little break right now and play another song by him. And that is going to be called Modus Agendi. So we'll be back in about 4 minutes. Y'all have a good time, and we'll see you in a few.
let me see.
We are back. Thanks for sticking around with our guest, Joe Dolezal, and we are going to pick up where we left off. Joe, you're back on. Everybody there?
I'm here. I am here. How are you guys doing?
Good. So where were we? You deliver the information so wonderfully. I love the way you break it down. You're doing a great job.
Yeah, we were talking about the relationships. I mean, do you guys want to cover anything else? Because we already swung by an hour almost here.
It's up to you, Grant. What do you think?
I'd like to know a little bit more about the Pyramid Center. Like, you know, what do you see for it? Is it going to be like a holistic retreat, an intentional community, a combination of the two, a Burning Man? You know, what's your vision for it?
A Burning Man.
meets Eureka.
Right. It's, you know, the Pyramid Center, it's going to be multifarious in intentions. It's not really going to serve one purpose as such. One thing that I really did want to maintain is essentially the integrity of the purpose of that center. And by that, I mean, I don't want it to turn, and it's not that I have anything against Burning Man. You know, I think it's a good festival. People can express themselves. A lot of people come together and they have fun, which is great. But, you know, on the other side of things, you know, when I, like I mentioned a little bit earlier, when we try to do these spiritual things, to me, it's a very earnest and a very serious subject matter. You know, it's not something that we just, you know, grab around a campfire, play guitar music and sing Kumbaya. I mean, there's a place and a time for that. But to me, spirituality is a very, very serious subject matter. And I think that one should even approach it with that type of intention and mentality. And by that, I mean, you know, austerity in whatever type of form, meditation,
sure, yeah,
eating good food, you know, and essentially a transformation of consciousness, a transformation of life. that inner being, that inner life. So what I want to do up there, rather than, you know, having big kumbayas, and not that we won't have, you know, major festivals for the public at times, but essentially what I want to keep up there is a type of very earnest spiritual mentality. So individuals that can come there, you know, they can maybe alter their diet if they have eating problems or eating disorders or weight problems. People who want to get in touch with themselves in terms of meditation, where they can actually go up there and brush up on their skills of concentration, meditation, understanding what it even is, you know, getting good solid foundational philosophical backgrounds on metaphysics, on spirituality, on, you know, religions, if they want to take that route, and even kind of, you know, delving around it a little bit in every category so they can see the underlying tone between everything and try to embrace more of that spiritual attitude rather than necessarily even stick to a particular dogma or a particular demarcation of some kind of ideology. So really what it would be is, you know, a spiritual retreat, yes, but I don't like to say spiritual retreat because I think that brushes the it essentially paints a certain impression into people's minds. What I tell people is, you know, if you go up and read up on your history of like what ancient Alexandria was set up by Alexander the Great, that's pretty much what I want to do. It's like a multifarious spiritual intellectual university, a nexus, like a meeting ground where people of all backgrounds can come, join, exchange ideas, meditate. You know, if they want to hang out for a day and then go home, that's fine. You know, if they want to hang out for a couple hours, go home, never come back, that's fine. If they want to live there as permanent residents and contribute to the Pyramid Center somehow, either through labor, either through finances, either through whatever, you know, whatever they can contribute to the pie to make it work a little bit better, that's
sure.
Fine too.
Yeah,
the Pyramid Center isn't one thing. You know, it's not going to be just a spiritual retreat or even a spiritual retreat for that matter, because though I will experiment with like sound healing and you know, obviously with healing intentions with like pyramid powers and stuff like that, by no means is that going to be what, you know, that's not going to be known what we're there for.
You don't want to put it in the box, and I love that. You know, I love that
right.
It's open.
Right, exactly. And I don't want to put it in a box. If anything, I want it to be much more broad and universal than anything else, because I think that's what it calls for. I think we have to stop staying away from this isolated ideologies of this is right and this is wrong and this is right and this is wrong, and try to look
exactly.
At the big picture, because that's where the answer is. It's in generalizing the bigger picture and understanding what's really behind the scenes and not necessarily focusing on one, you know, the truth is in Kabbalah or the truth is in magic or the truth is in, you know, I mean, these are all just ideologies of men at the end of the day. And it's not to say that there isn't some substantial truth in them, but it's just a small piece of the puzzle at best, you know.
So you seem like more of a holistic retreat, because that's kind of more encompassing of the crux of what sounds like you want to do there.
But again, yeah, I mean, you know, when we use that word holistic retreat, that even might seem like that we're just going to do like more like here's and you know, maybe like try to do like salt baths and stuff like that. And not to say
you
that
there's a
certain
like
connotation to it.
Right, exactly. And to me, you know, again, it goes back to that fundamental ideology where, you know, granted, I want people to get away from society because that's part of it. You know, part of it is to extricate yourself out of the, you know, current slavish matrix that we're in terms of, you know, making money, paying bills, you know, and then obviously the socioeconomic status of ego trips and trying to have a better car and a better job and look more attractive and, you know, wear more jewelry or, you know, make more money. So that there is that dynamic of trying to pull oneself away from that. And in that
sure.
respect, it'll be a retreat from the, you know, everyday slavish matrix that we live in. But, you know, at the end of the day, like, you know, like the subtitle of the Pyramid Center says, it's a place for inspiration. It's a place to come up and to kind of come down with something more substantial that you had before coming in there. Now, if that comes in the form of yogic meditation or if that comes in the form of some kind of healing event that happened as a result of the pyramid powers, if that happens because, you know, we happen to have an event that day and, you know, 5,000 people came and we all just, you know, sang and ate good food and listened to music, you know, however it happens, it happens. But at the end of the day, it's a place for inspiration. So I don't like to necessarily isolate it or demarcate it as, you know, a healing center or a retreat, because those words, they mean something specific. You know, retreat to me sounds like either it's some kind of like a, you know, a yo-yo Buddhist temple where we're not going to talk for, you know, 24 hours or, you know, or we're not going to talk for a month, because then that is a form of meditation. But I'm trying to do something a little bit more general and all-inclusive than something like that. And really, again, you know, if you research on what ancient Alexandria was, that's kind of more of my objective than anything else. And because that's so hard to pinpoint, because it's never existed since, you know, around 300 BC or AD rather, excuse me, since it's, you know, the demise, it had a 600-year lifespan and then Papal Rome brought it down. nothing like it exists. Nothing like it has existed since then. So people,
I love how you want to make it open to the masses, so anybody can come there of any social standing or into intellect and exchange ideas and coexist together for whatever time it is, and that can't help but everyone grow and leaps and bounds.
Right. Right, because, I mean, that's what it comes down to. Because, you know, I mean, if you truly want to help people, I think you have to be honest with yourself, or not even necessarily help. I don't like, you know, I don't like that whole save the world mentality, because, I mean, me, I'm very far away from that, you know, because it's, again, that comes into another spiritual discussion at the end of the day, too. But it's more about, you know, embracing humanity and doing the best you can for everybody, you know. And I think that's what it comes down to, because we see that these dogmatic polarizations, you know, if you want to call yourself a Christian Jew or a Muslim or, you know, an atheist or whatever it is, all you're really doing is you're creating a polarity. And again, you know, if we take into consideration that the law of the universe is equilibrium, then one day there's going to be a clash with somebody in some degree. It's just inevitable, because you're creating a polarity, whether it's good or bad. It doesn't matter. You're creating a polarity, and that polarity is naturally going to set up a type of clash or reaction sometime down the line. So if we want to obviate that clash and really help people, I think it's more about being all-encompassing, being universal, and offering a little bit of everything to everybody. And exactly like you said, of all intellects, of all backgrounds, you know, if you're super spiritual and you've attained the dynamic of magic because you understand how to control the electromagnetic force of life, great. You know, if you're completely new to this stuff and you don't know anything about anything, great. You know, it's more about, again, it's like offering a gift to humanity and trying to really be a boon rather than a burden through all these apparent helpful forces, you know.
You can learn something from a bum on the street, or you can learn something from Donald Trump.
Exactly. It's what you're looking for and how it's packaged at the end of the day.
Or if you're open to learn it.
Or if you're open, exactly. I mean, that's the first step, right? If you don't want to hear it, you don't want to hear it, and, you know, Jesus himself ain't going to help you. Yeah. So, I mean, that's really, you know, that is kind of, I guess, the all-around intention of the Pyramid Center. It's much more multifarious. It's much more dynamic than necessarily one thing, you know, and I know I don't express that in the, you know, and even in the website, I try to express it, because it's so difficult for people to understand what it, you know, what these things are. Because when you say ancient Alexandria, most people don't know what the hell that is, you know, other than a few historical scholars. Most people have no idea what that means when you say ancient Alexandria. They say, you know, what do you mean? Like, you know, and that's one of the reasons I didn't even bother looking for funders or anything, because I just kind of figure, you know, like, it's such a strange topic. You know, it's such an unconventional, I want to say strange. I say it's probably a much more unconventional subject matter in a much more unconventional way than anything that's been currently approached. You know, obviously investors would shy away from it because it's a huge shot in the dark, and I'm not interested in making money off of it. So, you know, there's not really going to be a yield in that respect, any kind of financial yield. And then donators, you know, any kind of a substantial donator is also a shot in the dark, because sometimes you can get lucky and somebody wants to help you. But most of the time, you know, what I've experienced is people love talking big, but when it comes to crunch time, everybody walks away, you know. So, you know, so it's just something like I've been putting along by myself, you know, putting money into it wherever, whenever and wherever I can. And, you know, like I said, I'm about 60-70% done. I've made a lot of headway, you know, especially in recent months. I've found, you know, a couple of good workers who don't mind doing a lot of that grunt work, because you have to have a certain mentality to be out there too. You know, it's not, like I said, if you're a city dweller and you do not like nature, I'll forewarn you ahead of time, you probably would not like this place, because it is out there. You know, it's in the mountains. It's in this beautiful open landscape. I love it. Most people I take up there, they're just like speechless, literally speechless. They don't even talk for the first 30 minutes when we get up there. So, you know, so the Pyramid Center really is going to be that, you know, a place of inspiration, something more multifarious, something more humanitarian in that respect, something which tries to diverge from this polar dynamic that we've had, you know, join this side, or this is the truth and that's the false, and we're fighting this and we're fighting that. It's just going to be like, listen, this is what, you know, this is what humans know. This is what we've come to the conclusion for. You choose your path. You know, everybody's got to have a different path. Christianity works for some people, and some people it harms a lot more, you know, and this is... And you could say the same thing for essentially any type of dogmatic tradition. You could say for any spiritual path, you know, even earnest spiritual paths, just like we were talking about earlier. Some people can do much better in certain spiritual paths than others. You know, some people can't concentrate, but some people can meditate maybe in the form of, like we said, karma or bhakti yoga, which is essentially serving, you know, the human race or the human interest, or even the world at large. With pure loving and unabridged intentions without returning anything or without any kind of return for your actions. So there's many forms of meditation. There's many forms of education. There's many forms of spirituality. It's not one thing, you know. Even though we'll all end up at the same place, you know, in the end. I mean, as they say, all paths lead to Rome. But, you know, there's many, 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 many approaches to apparently, you know, to this divine oneness that's behind everything.
Right. I know it's probably pretty hard to, you know, write a generalized prescription for something like this. But I know people are going to want to know, how do you suggest to people who don't know, or people who are almost there, people who aren't even close to being there yet, how to awaken their kundalini? Mm-hmm.
There's actually, if you go on the website, thepyramidcenter.org, that's thevpyramidcenter.org. I actually posted a link there on the left-hand side. If you scroll down a little bit, I made a webpage specifically for that called Kundalini Yoga. Because, yeah, I myself had a pretty substantial interest in the science of Kundalini for a couple of years now, about 5 years now. And, you know, I was a big devotee of Kundalini Yoga. I did a lot of the mantras and chants and a lot of the asanas, a lot of the breathing exercises, a lot of the prescribed meditations for Kundalini. And again, if you go to thepyramidcenter.org, scroll down right by free resources, you'll see a Kundalini Yoga page. You can just click that image and it'll take you into a separate page. And there's a bunch of free resources, video, audio resources. There's an entire book that you can read. There's high resolution images that you can download, and it's all for free. And what it basically is, you know, to do these types of things, there's an entire prescription for it. I'll go over it, of course, right now. Mm-hmm. But there's the third link. The third link below is a Kundalini Yoga ebook that you can download for free. And when you open that, it's basically about a 300 or 400 page book on the entire science of Kundalini.
Very cool.
Yeah, from beginning to end. So
go grab that one.
Yeah, if you want to take the time or the liberty to read that on your own time, it'll, you know, depending on your intensity, then you'll rip through that in a couple of days or a month, you know.
Right.
Essentially, you know, the idea of Kundalini is this. You have to take into consideration Kundalini Yoga is the more mystical yogic approaches. It's the more abstract approach to oneness, if you will. It's definitely not as easy as mantras or chanting or you know, it has a lot more faith-based. It has a lot more unique abstraction, and of course the intuition comes in that. But the basis of Kundalini Yoga is that this is you have seven chakras throughout your they're kind of psychically located in your spine. The seven chakras correspond, of course, to the seven elemental forces of the universe. And then you have the eighth chakra, which is the Sahasrara chakra. And this is kind of they call it the crown chakra. And this chakra is reached when you've mastered the seven before, or when you've reached enlightenment, or when you've reached the Buddha state or Christ consciousness. Then the eighth chakra is something that naturally activates itself as a result of this. The chakras essentially correspond to the physical elements of the physical elements of the universe, and then the higher ones, the more spiritual or etherical elements of the universe. I even gave a little brief description right there, but I'll kind of go over it again. The base chakra, which is kind of located in the base of the spine, then that one is actually, it's called the earth chakra, or the Mulanhara chakra, which is a Sanskrit word. All these again, if you go on the website, I have it described very, very lucidly at the top and kind of what they
I'm
are.
I'm glad breaking them down, because a lot of people know them, but there's many people out there that don't know what they are and what they do.
Right. Right. And then even some, you know, I've noticed a lot of the trends that, you know, people, they skew a lot of the stuff, you know, they chant Om necessarily, and they don't even know why they're chanting it or where it comes from and what you're supposed to do. Because there's, you know, truly to activate certain chakras, there's an entire ritual behind it. It's not, you know, like every chakra has its corresponding chant. For example, the Mulanhara chakra, you know, like the Mulanhara chakra, you're actually the center chakra, you're actually supposed to chant a certain word. It's like lam, L-A-M, but it's supposed to be more extended, like lam, and so you're supposed to really enunciate that L very slowly, and you're supposed to kind of pull it into the M and then chant that. But even the four lotus petals around it, there's four letters or four of these type of distinctions that you're supposed to chant first until you hit that fifth one in the middle, which is the L-A-M, Lam. And you're supposed to say this, you know, you're supposed to take a bath first. There's a whole ritual behind it. You're supposed to take a bath. You're not supposed to eat for at least 3 hours. You're supposed to be in an extremely calm state of mind with no other mental distractions.
It's like a detox almost.
It's like a detox, but it really is like a full-blown seance ritual almost, you know, when you're supposed to activate these things properly. You're supposed to even come into it doing some kind of pranayamic lung cleansing or breathing, some kind of, you know, essentially cleansing of the nostrils, the lungs, and you're supposed to correlate this consciously as you're doing it with spiritual cleansing. And then you're supposed to go into the elemental forces, you know, starting with the base chakra, which is the Mulanhara chakra. The second chakra, which is called Swadhisthana chakra, is corresponding with the water element of the universe. And this is ironically located in your bladder. And it's kind of interesting because you can see these chakras are located kind of in the organic correspondence, or they correspond with the organic elements even in your own body. So the Swadhisthana chakra is located in the bladder region, essentially. That's where it's in the spine, but it's kind of located parallel to the bladder. The next one up is the fire element, which is called Manipura chakra, and this is located pretty much in the heart of the stomach, in the digestive, and it's responsible for the digestive properties in the stomach, or even in the body for that matter. The next chakra, which is what most people correspond to the heart, is the Anahata chakra, and this is basically the heart chakra, the love chakra. This is supposed to be also equivalent to the air element of the body, and it's, again, it's right in between your lungs or the heart, and it's supposed to corroborate with the heart and the physical body. Vishuddhi chakra, the chakra, which is essentially in the throat, corresponds to the etherical element of the universe, you know, the ether, or that subtle electromagnetic force, if you will, for lack of a better term. It's essentially the ether of the universe, and that's where the fifth chakra, which is located in the throat, is located. Ironically, that's corresponding to speech in the physical. The next chakra, this is what most people constitute as the third eye, is the Ajna chakra, and that's located in the pineal gland and in between the eyes, or corresponding to the third eye, and that's the one people chant Om. That's kind of its chakric mantric meditation, is the Om, is the Om symbol. Again, there's two on the side of it, and the two on the side of it are actually supposed to be corresponding to the masculine and feminine energies of the universe, or the active and the passive energies, and then the Om's supposed to be more of an embracive universal understanding of everything. So when you chant these things, you have to keep in mind that you're trying to chant it with a certain feeling of full encompassing embrace, like, for example, in particular to the Ajna chakra. And
that's my favorite one, the third eye, though.
The third eye, right. And the third eye, again, you know, it's very powerful. I mean, I've done some meditation on the third eye, not a lot, but again, you know, that's the one that you walk away from and, you know, your whole face is just buzzing. You know, it's pretty...
Or one side of your bottom lip will be quivering. You know, it's pretty bizarre.
Right. And again, you know, they go into detail in that book about it, about, you know, about that this is, that that's actually one of the best things you can do, is because it essentially starts activating the pranic subtle forces within you. And we'll get to that in a second, because prana is something different from chakras. Chakras, again, they're a type of very subtle, even more subtle than the electromagnetic energy in your body. And they're essentially a type of like whirlpool swirls, which correspond to these physical locations that we just went to. And they are responsible. They are really the heart or the spirit of these elementals, you know, the earth element, the water element, the fire element, the earth element, the etherical communication element, and then ultimately the soul spirit element of the Ajna chakra, or the third eye, where essentially all this knowledge is emanates from. The last chakra, which is really the eighth chakra, is the Sahasrara chakra. And that's not something that's essentially something that comes as a result of mastering the seven chakras. It comes as a result, and they call this the crown chakra. And the crown chakra is because the light actually emanates and glows from the side of your head, and this is where you see, you know, portraits of saints or Jesus Christ. That's what that actually represents, is that light emanating from their head, because they've activated the eighth chakra, the Sahasrara crown chakra, because of a result of their meditation, or essentially their God consciousness that they've attained through their meditations or their spiritual practices. So that is what the seven, that is essentially what chakras are in the practice of Kundalini yoga. Now, before I go on to pranas, do you guys have any questions? Or
I'm pretty sure that this question applies. Someone had a question in chat. Have you ever experienced other physical realities while you are exploring the larger consciousness, or experienced telepathical communication?
Oh yeah, a lot. You know, what ironically got me into a lot of this Kundalini and thought power stuff is it was an experimentation 5 years ago, my personal experimentation with telekinesis, or moving things with the mind or thought power. You know, I've had so many unique incidences. for example, when I do intense pranayama, now I don't do this every day because of circumstance, and that's kind of why I'm going up to the center, is so I can really, really get in depth into a lot of the spiritual practice. That's really my sole objective of moving up there relatively soon, is so I can just fully devote myself to the meditative practice. But you know, just in my experience over the years that I have done this stuff on and off, and in intense cases, when I do my breathing exercises, then you know, I've had literally a type of black flame. It looks like cigarette smoke, but it's a little bit more refined, and I've seen it come off of me many, many times. And, you know, I thought that maybe I had some type of eye fatigue, or I was seeing something because I wanted to see it. And then my brother actually corroborated it with me. One time I was in the passenger seat of the car, and we were stopped at a stoplight at night. And, you know, he kind of outbursted all of a sudden and said, "Oh, my God, look at your knee. It's on fire." And, you know, and I know what he was talking about. Not that he saw any flames, but there's smoke coming out of it. It looks like smoke.
Wow, that's unbelievable.
And then it just disappears. And I've seen it so many times in the room coming off of me.
On your knee, of all things.
On my knee, yeah. And this only happens when I go through periods of very intense spiritual practice. Like in this case, I was doing pranayama, which is a breathing exercise, and we'll get into that in just a little bit. You know, many times also when, like for example, this happened recently about 2 months ago. I was doing a pranayama exercise here where, you know, essentially I do the breathing exercises. And then when I went to sleep, I woke up around 3 or 4 in the morning. And there was a woman standing above me about 4 feet away from my, and distinctly, I thought actually it was my roommate that was standing there. And I thought so much so that I reached out to touch it, because I come out of my sleep conscious state and I look, and distinctly, I just saw a silhouette, but it was very distinct silhouette because it's dark in my room. You know, I close all my windows so you wouldn't see anything but a silhouette, and of a medium height, probably in the mid 5 foot range. Had very like cut hair down right below her shoulders. If you kind of, you know, parted in the middle, very straight, and I could see that much. And then it had pretty much down to the shoulders. And I didn't see anything other than, you know, the body. It was like a slender woman. It wasn't a big woman. And from the vibe I got, it was relatively young. I would say probably late teens, in the 20s, probably no more than that.
When you reached out to touch it, did it have like a hot or cold temperature?
Disappeared.
So you went to reach out for it, it disappeared?
Yeah, and I woke up, I immediately recognized the form that was there for about 2 or 3 seconds, and I stared at it for maybe about a second or two, and then I reached out to touch it because I thought it was my roommate, and at that point, it pretty much just, like, it lightly backed up, slightly, and it disappeared. It didn't do anything, it didn't really even scare me, to be honest with you. I didn't have any type of nefarious intention, I didn't get any type of, like...
It could have been a guide.
It could have been a guide. It could have been a lost spirit. I mean, it could be a lot of things. You don't know. I mean, you know, they say when you know, in the spiritual scriptures, when they say when you start ascending towards your spiritual path, or, you know, you're going to come across a lot of things. You know, you'll come across magic. You'll come across the ability to levitate. You know, this is the higher echelons of spirituality. This is kind of like when you start becoming an ascetic. You don't talk to people for long times. And, you know, this is not like the lower echelons of spirituality, but rather the towards the butt end of it, right before Christ consciousness or spirituality, is that the gods will test you, they say. And they say that they'll introduce you sometimes with very sinister forces that to try to scare you. They won't do anything to you, because if you don't embrace them, because they're not really in this dimension, they can't do anything to you. You know, they can't really kill you. You know, they can't throw things at you. They can't beat you up. It's more like they'll come out and they'll try to scare you and intimidate you. And you know, it depends. Everybody reacts to fear differently. Everybody, you know, understands.
So they're not multidimensional. Beings,
well, they could be multidimensional, but they essentially say that they call them the devas, which in the Sanskrit term means gods, essentially, or the angels.
Okay.
And these angels, sometimes they're beautiful and they'll come and help you, and sometimes they'll try to steer you wrong intentionally, and they'll believe you that they'll try to persuade you that you've reached liberation or Christ consciousness or spirit.
On the demonic side almost.
Right, exactly. Sometimes they're just very playful and they just want to mess with you and they don't do anything. Sometimes, like in my case, I feel they just appear. They don't do anything. They don't say anything. They're just there and then they're gone. So that's, you know, those are just some of the few incidences that have happened to me. Again, you know, when I've done some of these more intense, you know, intense pranayamas, then I've had instances where I've woken up, and this has happened many times, at least 5 times that I can think of, that my entire ceiling, the entire roof of the ceiling, when I woke up in my bed, it was like, it was like blood red. It was like vermilion almost. It was a very intense glowing red, like almost like the inside. You know when they stick like those small probe cameras in like veins or arteries, and you kind of like, you can see the inside of it where it's like full of life, but it's very red and stuff like that. that's how all of it looked, pretty much. And then, you know, after a few seconds of staring at it, it kind of again dissipated after about 5 seconds when I came from that sleep conscious state to the waking conscious state. But it doesn't scare me. It's just I've noticed these things happening almost guaranteed in corroboration with the pranayamic or the breathing exercises. It almost happens in tandem almost every single time, guaranteed something unique or occult happens or spiritual happens in that respect. That when I do these breathing exercises. So, I mean, that's really just to name a few of the things that I've experienced. You know, that woman was relatively recently, you know, I see the red walls all the time. You know, the black flames I remember happened quite a bit. Very intense dreaming. Very, very, very.
Oh, yeah.
Intense.
Pretty intense dreams sometimes, too.
Yeah.
It's like an ebb and flow kind of thing, too, for me, though.
Right. And to me, it's like I can turn it on and off in accordance with the pranayamic exercises or the breathing exercises. When I do them intensely, almost guaranteed I'm going to experience something otherworldly, if you want to call it.
Astral.
For a lack of term. Yeah. And when I don't do it, then it almost never happens. So that's kind of the reason I stay away from it, is because, you know, I'm still kind of like on this side, taking care of business on this side, but I'm transitioning that way. And that's one of the reasons I'm actually moving up to the center on the first of next month. And that's my permanent home. And I'm taking it 100% from there.
I can tell you something I've seen once, if you want to know.
Yeah, go ahead.
I've seen it a few times coming, and I actually felt the energy coming from it. I took my hand there and felt the energy, like I was feeling a ghost, but it was myself.
Mm-hmm.
It was off of my heart chakra. You know how this is the only way I can describe it, I'm sorry for the layman's terms. Like when you pump gas on a hot day,
right?
The iridescent vibe in the air,
right?
That you can see, it almost looks like that.
Right.
Coming off
right.
Of my heart chakra.
Right, and it emanates, you know, and that's kind of what's cool in that book that I recommended that you guys can download for free. It actually goes into like how the colors look and the shape and the feeling and what, you know, what part of the blood they're responsible for. But exactly, I mean, everybody will see and interpret these things differently, but you'll definitely have a unique experience when you start experimenting with the higher echelons of the spiritual practice.
Joe, do you have anything on your website about this pranayama breathing that people can start to look at, maybe expose themselves to?
You know, I don't. I probably should, and that didn't even occur to me. However, again, if you go to the Kundalini and you download that book, then that book, there's a section, an entire chapter or two in that book that's dedicated to the pranayamic exercises, and it actually it addresses specific pranayamic breathings that address Kundalini and even prana activation and Kundalini activation. Here, I actually have the book open in front of me. And right here, it's actually it's in the beginning, and it has a little introduction in the book, because it's a pretty big book. It's like well over 100 pages. It's about 200 and something pages for the book. Towards the later end of it, on like page like 50 or something like that, according to this PDF, it says pranayama, what is it? And then it pretty much goes, and it'll give you the basic theories of pranayama. It'll tell you what the prana is responsible for, what it means, why you do it, how it's correlated to the spirit, and why, you know, restraining the breath corresponds to restraining certain spiritual dynamics within the body itself. But again, you know, I do want to give a heat of advice. Like me in particular, I do something called Bastrika, which is a very rapid inhalation, exhalation 25 times. And then you inhale very deeply and hold your breath. First, you start off 72 seconds, then you go on a minute and a half, and then you even take it up to about 2.5 minutes of holding your breath without breathing, inhale or exhale.
I wonder if that lack of oxygen does something to trigger.
I think it does. You know, and I just, you know, a heat of advice to some people, if you're not super healthy, if you had bad cardio, you know, if you have cholesterol problems, then you definitely want to take it very easy with this and don't, you know, beef it up intensely. They say, you know, starter. Especially, you know, I run, and I have for about 10 years, I've run habitually like many miles. So my cardio is pretty good. You know, people who might be older or not in the best physical shape, probably start off, if you want to do it, do just, you know, like maybe 3 inhalations, like deep inhale, exhale, maybe 3 times to 5 times, and then hold your breath for maybe only 32 seconds and then release it. And then do those cycles, you know, and kind of ease your way up to it. You know, you don't want to go extreme, and, you know, the objective of spirituality is you never want to hurt yourself. You know, some people think that destroying or mutilating your body is spiritual. It's not. You don't want to do that. You know?
Oh, no.
Yeah, yeah. Some people get the impression that, you know, like intense austerity or discipline and hurting your body is spiritual. It's not. The spiritual practice should always be a positive ascension, a type of positive escalation or an ascension towards something greater and more general. So when you're doing these breathing exercises, you kind of want to keep that in mind, you know, that it's essentially, it corresponds to, again, and this is a little bit more of an abstract, I guess, subject to understand, but it comes down to the duality. Because you're in the physical body and because everything in you is responsible or actually corroborates with this apparent duality of the universe, you know, like we said, the ebb and flow or the masculine feminine, your heart, your actual physical heart corresponds with that because it beats. It goes ba-bum, ba-bum, ba-bum. So it actually does a type of active spewing, you know, when it releases the blood, and then it takes in the old blood and it recycles it, which is kind of like the feminine nurturing energy.
More efficient and rhythmic.
It's more efficient and rhythmic, but it's something much more profound and subtle than that. You know, it's really about trying to cessate this ebb and flow, because it corresponds to the apparent dualities, the likes, the dislikes, the good and the bad, the heat and the cold, because, you know, it's this apparent duality which is so deeply ingrained in our psyche and in our spirit that we develop personalities and egos, and it's really what inhibits us from God consciousness. So you want to try to cessate these type of tendencies by doing that. So when you're doing pranayama, pranayama is a Sanskrit word which means restriction of the breath, then you're trying to control that breath, because the breath corresponds to the heart, and the heart corresponds to this, this evolution or this opening up of this entire dual universe. So if you can kind of cessate or subside these apparent dual fluxes within yourself, then the idea is that you actually start returning towards that one God consciousness again. And, you know, it's such a difficult thing to appreciate and even understand, you know, from an intellectual perspective, because it's not a mind operation. You know, again, when we deal with the spiritual, spirituality is the subject of the other side, if you will. It's essentially the invisible or the non-phenomenal. So, you know, even somebody like me, who's apparently a good speaker and I can articulate, well, that's fantastic. But, you know, you don't really ever say anything about spirituality, because it's something which can't be articulated. It needs experience behind it. When you're doing these things, you kind of have to, you know, slowly do it. Don't go too intense into it, because you can hurt yourself, obviously. And like you even said, you know, the lack of oxygen to your brain in some cases can give you altered states, which can or can't be real. But you don't really want to do that, because the idea is that you want to have positive experiences and experiences with meaning. You know, there are health benefits to pranayama, like it oxygenates your blood. You know, a lot of diseases are caused due to lack of oxygen in your blood, because we don't breathe regularly. So pranayama actually does have even physical benefits, because it oxygenates your blood and gets rid of a lot of toxins, a lot of carbon dioxide in your blood. So, you know, it's kind of a fine line. It's kind of a fine medium. When you're embracing these things, again, do it, you know, try to understand it in theory as much as possible, and then practice. And then when you practice, you know, you don't want to go overboard and hurt yourself, because in the spiritual pursuit, we're not hurting ourselves.
Don't go for the quick fix.
Yeah, and there's no quick fix. You know, there's nothing, unfortunately, there's nothing you can do, you know, to make it happen tomorrow. You know, no matter how intense you're going to practice, you know, every spiritual doctrine I read says don't. It's not about the intensity. If you can intensify it, if you have the time and the willpower and it's not killing you and you're not, you know, a hateful person, then great, you know. But it's better, you know, evolution is better than revolution, as they say.
Nothing worth having comes easily.
Right, exactly. And especially in something like this, there really is no shortcuts. It's kind of baby steps. You know, read up on your theory first. If, you know, if your guests have any questions, they can always email me, joe@thepyramidcenter.org.
Okay.
Yeah. And they can also go on the website, thepyramidcenter.org, and then if you just go under contacts, then my info is right there as well.
Someone asked a question. I know it's probably off topic where we are now, because it's been in the news lately. The pyramid in Bolivia putting off an energy light beam.
Right. I've heard about that. That situation. And I don't know. You know, I mean, it's difficult to say. I've read a lot of quote unquote scientific researchers that believe that there's actually like a type of orticular helix energy coming out of the capstones of some of the pyramids in Egypt. You know, I've seen the documents, but today with Photoshop and a very creative mind, you could almost do anything. I wouldn't doubt it, because of what I think, you know, and again, these things could be even taken out of context and be drawn to something that it maybe isn't. But, you know, I did a radio interview on Saturday, it wasn't actually so much about spirituality, because we only had an hour and it just flew by, but it was a lot of it was about pyramids. And they even, you know, the word pyramid, it actually means fire in the middle. And what it's supposed to be is the pyramid itself is supposed to be a physical representation of the sun. And by that, I essentially mean that the sun, the reason that cultures venerated the sun so much in the past is because not so much that the sun gives love and light to the world, but it does, but it's more about what it represents. The sun represents essentially the nexus or the equilibrium between this side of the universe, which is the physical side of the cosmos, the dual side, and the other side, which is the entire spiritual or non-physical or, you know, exist before it was existence side. And because the sun is in perfect equilibrium between this side and that side, because it gets its energy from that side and then comes in this side, and then this side goes back to that side through, you know, what we would constitute as black holes or this type of point singularity energy, then the pyramid is supposed to represent that in the context that the apex is supposed to be equivalent to the sun in the sense that it's a transversant or it's a medium or a nexus between this side and that side. And that's why when we see the pyramid and the apex, for example, the apex is supposed to represent the point singularity between the physical side of the world or the physical side of the universe, which would in this case, you know, it could be the world, it could be anything physical, and this is even why we have four sides, which corresponds to the four elements. The apex of that is essentially that point nexus singularity that goes into the other side or the spirit side or the side before existence. So, you know, I wouldn't doubt that it would emanate any type of energy. I don't know specifics about the Bolivian pyramids. I mean, I've read a lot about, you know, the Bolivian pyramids, and then there's the Bosnian pyramids, which is, the largest pyramid that they discovered. Now they're discovering pyramids in the Bermuda Triangle off the coast of Georgia that, you know, that are massive, and then they're discovering pyramids off of Japan that are 10,000 years old. At least 10,000 years old is what they've carbon dated the pyramids off the coast of Japan. So
underground and underwater, I'm fully convinced.
Everywhere. And I mean, again, that's only what they tell us, you know. I mean, I'm sure there's a lot more to it, but obviously the pyramid plays a substantial role, and it has many meanings. It's not just a structure. The structure itself represents something. And like I said, I believe it corroborates with the sun, or essentially it's that point nexus, that absolute equilibrium between this side and the spirit side, and it essentially represents the nexus or the communicating means between this side of the world and that side of the world, and it's a physical representation of that. The word pyramid, it's a composite word of pyra or pyro, which in the Greek means fire, and then mid, M-I-D, in the middle. That's what the word pyramid actually means, fire in the middle. So what fire are we talking about? We're talking about the generative force of the universe, which again is that nexus between this side and that side. It's that subtle generative energy which gives life to all things, which is the sun. But again, you know, it's something much more subtle than that. You can't look at it. We're not talking about physical content here anymore. We're talking about more of a subtle feeling or general embrace and understanding of certain phenomenon.
That's fascinating. Do you do work now with healing? I know you said you're going to get into it. Do you do any healing work or...
I'm trying to stay away from, like, I'll always help people. If anybody has questions, I always answer pretty much any question that I get, you know, and I always help people. And if, you know, people want to come out with me and do pranayamic breathing exercises or any kind of spiritual meditation, I'm open to it. But I mean, I don't charge people for this kind of stuff. And even like we did the natal chart, like I'm kind of habitually against that, you know, because I think it's a form of spiritual prostitution, and I'm just not into it, you know. And I've made a lot of enemies saying stuff like that because, you know, there's a lot of people that make money off spirituality, and it's not to say that they're not legitimate. I'm sure they have a force, but again, you know, and I believe this theory that, you know, and they even say that, you know, you should never use your spiritual talents for lower purposes, like trying to make money off of it. You
exactly.
know, you should always have your side job. And then if it's something that, you know, you should stay true to yourself and help people because, you know, you believe, or you at least to some extent understand that, you know, we are all our brother's keepers. So you want to help the people just because, you know, you feel like it's not even an obligation, but because it is all around the best thing to do to help people with the gifts that you have. And not really sell it and stuff. So I'll help anybody if they want, you know.
I agree with you about that for the most part. Of course, some people need to make money.
They need to make money, exactly. But, you know, I mean, you know, what happens, and this is really the catastrophe in a lot of this stuff, is you start getting all these mediums and psychics and intuitive healers. And, I mean, let's face it, they're charging $250 an hour. And it's not to say that there's not some legitimacy in it, but then you're putting a price on something which shouldn't have a price. And this is kind of even what's demeaning in, you know, in physical prostitution with women, is you're essentially putting a price on something that shouldn't have a price. You're putting a cash value on
absolutely
it, you know? And that's really where I think the blunder, or really the fatal blow, happens, is because then you're bringing it down. Well, $250, that's how much my stereo costs. Why does, you know, why does the best of this person or this type of, you know, God phenomenon cost as much as, you know, putting three tanks of gas in my car? And it just really undermines and vitiates the entire spiritual pursuit, not to mention that it really establishes and creates an entire plethora of charlatans and whack jobs and ripoffs, and, you know, and that further even undermines the spiritual pursuit. So
not only that, but I believe that channeled information, if you will, can be infiltrated or messed with.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean,
don't know if it's actually coming from pure source.
Right, exactly. And you have to be very, very careful, because just because you're getting channeled information, you don't know where the hell that channel's coming from. You know, that could be from anybody and anything. And not to mention, you know, the government technologies even admitted through projects like HARP, Project Bluebeam, you know, which are established government projects. They can literally send electromagnetic signals into your head, and you feel like you're having a divine revelation. But
our show last week was all about those kind of weapons.
Exactly. So, you know, I mean, the spiritual stuff aside, you really don't know where this information's coming from, you know. And it's, again, you know, it's not to not be kind of, you know, a negative Nancy or a panic attack about it. But again, it's like, if you want to help people and there's nothing to gain from it because you're just trying to dissipate information for the sake of helping them because they asked you, then there's nothing wrong with that. But a lot of times, you know, this save the world or heal the world mentality through my gift because I think I'm God attitude, really creates such a devastation, you know, ultimately it creates such a devastation. This is really the basis of cults. You know, this is the basis of perverted dogmatic religion, you know, and we just really have a plethora of degeneracy and negativity happening out of these things. So, again, you know, help people, yes, but understand that psychic powers and even magical powers, levitation, intuition, mediumship, this is just, it's just, you know, it's a very introductory spiritual psychic powers. There's some legitimate people, and there's some, you know, charlatan quack jobs that need to be locked up in a mental institute. But at the end of the day, it's just like, understand that it's not the ultimate truth. And everything that you think somebody can help you with, it's latent within you. You know, the truth is in you. It's not out there. It's not in people. It's not in psychics. It's not in medium. It's definitely not in churches. It's in you, you know.
Trust your inner voice.
Exactly. And I think that's the biggest struggle that people really should spend a lot of time, is distinguishing their emotions, their personal emotions versus their intuition. The intuition, your personal intuition has all the answers, and it is your best friend. It is really your guide. It is everything that you need and much more, you know.
Absolutely. And that just goes to show that everyone has that gift to just want to tap into it.
Exactly. And it's latent in everyone, you know, and that's why, again, you know, when I go to these, you know, when I go to a lot of these quote unquote new age movements, I'm borderline disgusted with it. So that's kind of where I stand in that. You know, I always help people. If they have any questions, feel free to ask me. I do a pretty good job, as you see, articulating and, you know, shooting certain ideas over to people. Again, you know, true spirituality versus theory is light and day. You know, when you start having spiritual revelations, it's such a magnificent feeling that you really start imbuing yourself with a sense of general conscious understanding, which is so beautiful when you can look at even terrible situations and understand why it is the way it is, you know, and understand
Absolutely.
It and even accept situations. I mean, there's a certain type of power that comes with that, which is inexplicable in words.
You're very giving with your time, Joan, and I think that that's a great, beautiful gift that you're giving to anybody you come across. Just the other day when you went through my chart, you didn't have to do that, but you did it because that's what you do and you enjoy doing that. It's interesting to you. And
I mean, to me, it's not work. To me, it's just like I'm broadening my spiritual understanding, and then, you know, you're getting something too, because like I said, that's why I even told you, like when we were doing it, to me, it's like, tell me if I'm wrong, because I mean, you know, then it's good. At least you could tell me where I'm wrong. You're not going to offend me. You're not going to make me sad. You're not going to break my heart. It's good, because then at least you'll be like, oh, maybe I need to go back and re-research this stuff.
Everything you said made perfect sense.
Right. No, I mean, and it's kind of amazing because, you know, other than the talk we had yesterday, I've never really spoken to you at all. But there, you know, how many, you know, 10 or 15 traits about your personality that were very prominent, I just, you know, nailed without, you know, without even giving it much thought, just because I was reading your natal birth chart.
Thank you for that.
Oh, yeah, no problem.
So, if I'm understanding this right, you do not sell any books.
Currently, I don't sell anything. I don't even ask for donations, and I have those resources which are for free. You know, you can listen to my, you know, my rants about certain things like the Illuminati and aliens attacks, pyramid astrology video. You know, I have the Pyramid Center promotional video on my website. So, you know, all those things are obviously, you know, free, and then radio interviews and then resources and stuff like that. I plan on writing a book down the future, but that's so down the future that, you know, I would even say we'll worry about it when it happens.
Do you want to go into that Illuminati topic?
Okay, yeah, no, I mean, I did a several videos. It was actually part of a series that an individual that came down from Canada, he, you know, I personally, I'm kind of weird. I don't like going public with a lot of stuff, and it's not that I'm scared. It's just I feel that there's a type of diminution or a truncating of intensity of spiritual ideas when you send it out to the public, because then people have opinions and they undermine it and they embrace it back with a type of negative energy. And again, it's not a fear, it's more of an indifference. And it's at the end of the day, it's like, if I argue with you and I persuade you of everything that you ever thought about life was wrong, it's like, what did I really gain? You know, I don't, I'm not looking to hypnotize people. I don't care about saving the world. You know, I don't care about telling people that, you know, Christianity is wrong and this is the right God. And I don't care. You know, I don't care. I'm happy being my own person, doing my own thing. That's another reason I'm going to the mountains. You know, I don't feel like I have anything to prove, and I don't want to waste my time in that pursuit anyways. So, you know, so what we did is essentially, you know, at the end of the day, why I'm saying that is because, so, you know, we go down the line, this guy stayed with me for a couple of weeks, and he wanted to come out with these videos, and he's just like, you know, because we talked a lot about stuff, you know, just me and him in private, and he's like, man, you got to make these videos, you got to make these videos, and I'm like, I don't want to, so... Last night he was here, you know, we basically, you know, it was like 12 o'clock in the morning. We've got my Canon 7D camera out, and he's just like, let's just do it. So we just sat down for like 4 hours. I was just sitting in the same chair, and that's why all the videos pretty much are me sitting in front of this fireplace, because that's actually in my room, and we slammed out all the videos just literally in like 2-3 hours. All improv, no, you know, it's just all off the top of my head. And, you know, as a result, we did some stuff about, like, what the idea of God is, because I did a lot of etymological research on that. And all this stuff is on the pyramidcenter.org website. You know, I talk about astrology. I talk about the divine active and passive principles and what that is. I kind of go into magic. And then another video is about the Illuminati and then numerology. And then finally, aliens attack. Is it real or fake? I mean, I don't care. We can go on to any subject, or I see that there's a question that popped up here. You know, again, if your viewers want to see that on, you know, after the show, they can just go to thepyramidcenter.org, and all the videos are there with a lot of radio interviews as well. But do you guys have any questions, or should I just go on?
Tamara had a question in the chat room. Will your pyramid be built using materials that will channel healing energies, or is it just the shape that creates the healing energies?
From the research that I've done, it seems that materials have an influence, but it's the structure of the pyramid that's more important than the influence has, than the material as such. So what I plan currently, you know, there's, if you go on the website and you go on to the Pyramid Center promo video, then there's a pretty in detailed CAD image drawing, or a video rather, a 3D rendering video that kind of flies through how I kind of want it to stand. Because of certain, I guess, impediments that might happen as a result of that, you know, and because, again, of resources available to me, because of knowledge available to me, then I'm kind of just going off of the fact that I'm going to have to build it alone like I have been, then what I probably end up doing is I'm going to polish granite, because I have tons of granite rock everywhere around, and I want to do a 7-step apex. The entire, first of all, so you understand where I'm building the pyramid, the mountain actually ascends, so I want to kind of keep that general slope upwards. So the entire mountain is basically the base of the pyramid, and then where I would actually construct my pyramid would really be the capstone of the pyramid, if you will, if you can imagine that.
Wow, that sounds awesome.
Yeah, because the pyramid, it's like 700 feet below, you know, I mean vertical, and then it's about 1,400 feet in distance from the top, and then I have this plateau up top. Again, if you watch the promo video, you'll see that. And what I want to essentially do is polish granite. I have tons of granite lying around. Then I want to essentially go to myself or hire somebody while I'm there and polish all the granite around, and then just do a 7-step apex. And from the sides of it, I want to run some kind of conducting beams. I don't know what that's going to be. You know, if I have enough money, I'll make it out of gold. I don't care. But we could even do copper. We can do steel. We can do some kind of like a granite composite material with a rebar, with some rebar in it in case of earthquake happens, then it won't collapse. And then the apex of that pyramid or that structure, the four beams coming up, there would be essentially like a square up top where you can interchange the capstones. Why? Again, the pyramid itself is responsible for one type of phenomenon, one type of energy, but then interchangeable capstones are responsible for something different. So if we put, you know, gold capstone or silver capstone or a steel capstone or a rock capstone, or if we use crystal, everything's going to have a different influence and energy, and whatever's below it, you know, meditating or running experiments on below it when we interchange those capstones.
That's cool.
Yeah, so essentially that's pretty much my vision of it as it stands right now today.
So you're going to keep a crane on site so you can lift those capstones up there?
You know, you could, there's like these little blue, I don't know if you're familiar with them, but they're like these little blue carts that can kind of like raise up. They're like hydraulically lifted, and then you can move side to side. So yeah, probably something like that than a crane.
Oh, cool.
Maybe use sound to levitate them.
Exactly. No, like they, like the Buddhists over in England did. Then the Queen published that report in the late 1800s about how the Buddhist monks in Tibet, they were doing some type of a mantra or a chat. It was some kind of music. I don't know what it was, but they were literally levitating like 2-ton rocks 400 or 500 feet above them into caves. Yeah, they were doing some kind of a chant, and it was something to do with the music and pretty intense stuff. But yeah, maybe something like that, or maybe like a guy in the Coral Castle.
Yeah, at least Galen.
Exactly. Maybe I'll figure out his secret. He said that the ancient Egyptians had it figured out, but he's not going to tell anybody because the world is not ready for that kind of knowledge, and I tend to agree with him 100%. Unfortunately, I think that the people who don't need to get it already know it, though, which is the best.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah, they've already got that figured out.
Yeah, I think they already got that one figured out, so unfortunately, you know, it's half correct theory.
This has been most informative. It'd be cool if you could have, you know, little like huts, or not huts, but like little, you know, single residencies on site with a different type of energy vibe built like a pyramid that
people actually
stayed in for the night, you know?
Right. Well, that's ironic that you say that because, again, if you go on the promo, the Pyramid Center promo video, then there's actually, I have one prototype bungalow completed, but my intention was, and I don't mind this because I can knock that out, right? Like I said, one of my big things right now is getting water up there. But building the bungalow is super easy, and in 30 days, I could pretty much have, you know, a demolished frame turned into an absolutely luxurious living suite. So, I mean, I don't mind doing that. It's not a hard thing for me to do. But one of the things I wanted to do is have several bungalows on site throughout the premises, and everything would have a different spiritual theme. So, you know, one would have like maybe like a Sufi theme, one would have a Kabbalistic theme, one might have like a Masonic theme, you know, and then kind of just variegate it. So none of the bungalows are essentially the same. And I think it would be kind of a cool, I know it's a little spiritual Disneylandish, but I thought it would be kind of a cool.
I like it.
Yeah, I thought it would be kind of a cool idea myself, so maybe I'll roll with that still. But
I think I'll have the crystal capstone tonight, thank you very much.
Right, exactly. Right?
and the full moon can clean it out for you every time, too. Clear that energy out that was in there before, you know?
Right. So any other questions we have?
Do you want to go into the alien connection anymore, or the...
Oh, yeah, we touched up on that a little bit in the beginning. Yeah, I mean, I guess, you know, to top it, you know, to kind of end that discussion, it's just, you know, like I've already mentioned, I feel that there are very, you know, very dynamic life forms out there in the universe. But I think what we're about to see in the next, you know, probably starting in the next 5 to 10 to 15 years is going to unfortunately be what we would constitute as the shadow government of this world, you know, playing certain things off of people so they can essentially justify this new world order. And that, you know, just like 9/11, they'll make a real event happen, you know, just like they showed in Battle LA, you know, they're telling you basically what's going to happen. You know, then all of us, irrespective of our races, socioeconomic credo or backgrounds, you know, we all got to get together to fight this nemesis. But you have to trade off all your rights to the government. So it's, you know, that's kind of how I feel about it. It's very unfortunate. You know, it's very unfortunate. And I say unfortunate because so many people are going to fall for it. And even so many people in this quote unquote New Age truth movement are, you know, playing so hard off of it, you know, and it's not to say that I don't, you know, I even think we as humans, I speculate that we as humans are probably not indigenous to this planet. I think that we probably came from somewhere else. You know, I think that we probably, you know, our history is so much more dynamic. I don't believe that we came from apes. It doesn't even make sense because why would apes be here if that's what we evolved from?
We have tails in vitro like a reptilian, so, you know,
right.
How much ape is in a reptilian.
Right, but even the reptilian thing, you know, that's you know, that theory, it seemed to have emanated out of David Icke, and he got that from an African shaman. I forget his name. I used to know his name, but he was a big
African Muswa.
Yeah, thank you, that guy right there. And, you know, this whole reptilian theory, it seems to emanate out of the fact of something that's called ayahuasca, and, you know, probably won't have time to touch up on it right now, but your readers, or rather your viewers, they can Google search a book called The Cosmic Serpent. And that's a small book, super cheap. You could probably buy it for under $10 on Amazon. It's called The Cosmic Serpent.
Okay.
And essentially what it is it's a PhD doctoral thesis on a guy over here in about the 60s or 70s that went down to South America, and he stayed with one of the native tribes down there to experiment with ayahuasca. Now, why I'm saying this is because what happens when you seem to experiment with this ayahuasca or take this brew, this potent brew, there's a number of very interesting phenomena that happen. One, You always seem to see a snake when you're in this super potent hallucinogenic trance. And what's even crazier is that 95% of the time, you can ask this snake when you're in this trance any question that you want, and it will tell you the correct answer when you come back to. So if you want to know a remedy for AIDS, or if you want to know a remedy for, you know, curing some kind of an illness, somehow it'll tell you what plants to mix and how to mix it and how to composite it, according to this book, at least. And it will tell you the answer. Now, why I'm saying this is because this kind of corroborates with Moses' snake of wisdom. Why does the snake keep appearing when you're in these hallucinogenic altered states? And what's even crazier is that they seem to, you know, they seem to work almost every single time. So why I'm saying that, though, is because I think this reptilian theory, or these reptilians coming as some type of nefarious, intelligent, super intelligent alien beings, I think this is more of a misinterpretation from altered states, from the Africans probably using some type of substance like ayahuasca, if not ayahuasca itself. And it's the misinterpretation probably somewhere down the lines that, you know, they say we see this snake or this type of reptilian being, it tells us what we want to know. And then it's mistranslated, and now people believe that there's reptilians living in the Vatican basement running the entire world. You know, again, my personal theory, I just, you know, I don't buy that.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah, that's just kind of how I feel about that particular subject matter. But in terms of, you know, extraterrestrials and stuff like that, you know, I feel that there has to be a vast amount of life out there. And I feel that even our own, the human story, if you will, the true human history, when we talk about, you know, 10, 15,000 years plus into the past, I think that, you know, I think that we've generated rather than evolved as a human race. And I think that we were much more powerful back then. I think a lot of more people were prone and able to do things that we would constitute as magical. I think that, you know, I think that we have a very dynamic legacy, you know, in the past as human races, and that we've really fallen a great deal. And, you know, I think a lot of people, they don't want to admit that. And I think a lot of people, they're very, you know, people don't like to take personal responsibility for themselves. So they always have to point the finger. It's the Vatican's fault. It's the government's fault. You know, it's the illegal Mexicans' fault. It's always somebody else.
You don't have to believe the hype.
Right. I mean, you don't even have to believe the hype, but it's rather than, you know, it's like, you know, why don't you just, you know, why don't you shut up and man up, you know, why don't you take responsibility and recognize your own greater potential, you know, and that's kind of how I feel. And I think this whole extraterrestrial thing is just a lot of these new agers. They're just so hoping that somebody's going to come save us out of this mess. It's like, nobody's going to save you. You're going to either save yourself or you're going to die. That's it. You know,
we got to clean our own house.
Right, exactly. It's like, don't save the world. You know, nobody's going to come and save you, because at the end of the day, you know, that's your ego again telling you that you're something big. You know, the human race, for the most part, it's, you know, it's caused a lot of devastation to this planet and to each other and to animals and to the energy of the world, you know. So if the extraterrestrials, if they were real, they probably wouldn't come here to help us, like they even said. So it's, again, it's a sticky subject, because I believe
they probably look at us and go, you idiot.
Right, why haven't you already killed yourself, right? But again, you know, like that's, I feel that there has to be a tremendous amount of life out there. And I feel that our human history is very, very dynamic. But again, you know, this what we're going to see, like I said, in the next few decades with this extraterrestrial spoof. Unfortunately, I'm of the volition that it's a complete hoax by the government utilizing high technologies that they learned in the 1930s that they won't release to the public.
I have no doubt about that either.
Yeah.
They want all the keys to the candy stores, you know?
Yep.
Pay no attention to the great and powerful Oz.
Right. He's just
the man behind the curtain.
And doing his thing, right?
Very true. Well, this has been, we've touched so many topics. It just amazes me how much we can get through in a couple hours. Rand, do you have anything? I know you wanted to ask a couple things. I'm not sure.
If somebody wanted to pursue more in the magic, you know, somebody who's, let's say, a muggle and wanted to, you know, a newbie, wanted to research more, what would you recommend for books in that respect?
There's, you know, for people who, you know, who like more like magical rituals, there's a book called The Golden Dawn, which is by an individual named Israeli Regardi. You could actually Google search the term Golden Dawn and the book will probably come up. Rather, actually, if you go to Amazon.com and you Google search, Amazon search the term The Golden Dawn, then there's a book that'll come up in terms of ritualistic, alchemic, medieval magic. And that's like, it's a huge 900-page book that it should be in 8 volumes. And it's by a guy named Israeli Regardi.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. If you want something a little bit more non-ritualistic, something that comes more from activating through your own willpower, activating, you know, controlling your electromagnetic force, Things like levitation and Kundalini yoga is a very interesting, the book that I recommended, Kundalini yoga is a very interesting book to look into in terms of activating certain psychic powers like levitation, telekinesis, intuition, and that kind of stuff. But these things are hard. You know I say it very lightly, but they're hard to come across. It's not something you're probably going to spend a weekend in and then all of a sudden figure it out. You know, in many cases, you'd have to spend many, many years in these things and even devote a significant portion of your life and time and energy into these and not just do it as a 1 hour fluke thing a day. But it will happen eventually because, you know, even the things that I've seen that I don't like talking about, I'm fully convinced that it's absolutely real.
That's great. I am afraid we're going to have to cut it short right now. Joe, thank you so much for coming. We'd love to have you back anytime. It's been so...
For sure. For sure. You guys let me know and thank you for having me on.
You're a gracious guest.
Thanks, Joe.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank Patajali for giving us the music for the show we had this evening. You can find more of his music on ReverbNation.com and give a shout-out to the Occupy Movement, say mic check. I'd like to also recommend everyone to go check out some books from former guests we've had, Extreme Prejudice by Susan Lindauer, Innocence Turned Deadly by Robert Duncan O'Finian, The War on Drugs with Jeffrey Dywood, and Leo Zagami, Illuminati Secrets and Confessions of Illuminati, and Michael Sweeney's got 7 books on the powers, abuse of power, and personal privacy and control issues. And I'd like to thank everyone at our Truth Connections page on Facebook, give you a shout-out, say thanks for being there. Anyone's welcome to join. And thanks to my wonderful partner, Tamara Natividad, for doing everything she does behind the scenes. I'm going to play that last song by Patajali, and it's called The Pentagon in the Pentagram. Everybody can stick around and enjoy that song. And here it goes.
Something happening here.
Hi, everyone. Tamara here. Just a reminder that you can connect with us on Facebook, as well as subscribing to us on our YouTube channel. We'd love you to join us during live shows at blogtalkradio.com/truthconnections. And for information on upcoming shows, visit our website at truthconnections.wordpress.com. Thank you for your support, and never forget that the truth is reality and the connection is you.
Take a look at the symbology. You take a look at structures all over the world. They have told us what they are doing. They have identified themselves. We are identifying the enemy. We have identified the enemy.